And we've gone a little bit longer today in singing and praying. I don't think that's a bad thing, you know. It's going to be hot, basically. I mean, we'll come back for a business meeting, discuss a few things, finish decorating for VBS. We'll have some flyers and things for you to hand out, and we'll put some things on the social media for you to share. The biggest thing is to just go invite people. And again, just want to tell you about Vacation Bible School is, you know, certainly you may attract some people Saturday, just people seeing us out here doing what we're doing. But the other part is, again, personally invite people. That's the number one thing with church or anything else. And Charles does this a lot with people he encounters. And you know what? Everybody doesn't come. But so far, as I don't know, nobody shot him yet or tried to beat him up for it, you know. So I don't guess anybody's even screamed at him about it. I know sometimes we get worried about that. You know, they may not want to hear it. Well, just invite them. See what happens, you know. The same thing when I go into a business to talk to folks. So far, I hadn't had anybody run me out and tell me to get away. I even go to the ones that say no soliciting and say, I'd just like to share this card with you and see what happens from there. So, but I do want you, if you would, to open up the Word of God. And I am trying to see just what... Oh, I know what I did. Hang on just a minute. I put my sermon notes down, and I know I did preach a sermon a little while back without notes. I don't know if y'all consider that a success or a failure. I might have preached too long without them, but I was getting back into the book of Galatians, and today we want to go back to talking about justification by faith, and we're going to go to the sentimental argument, and we're going to look at verses 12 through 20, and yes, hopefully next Sunday we'll then have a screen back up here to do some things with. But we are going to resume our study in the book of Galatians. We've been dealing with the subject matter of justification by faith, which is a subject of this glorious book of the Bible. And so today, as we go back to this book and resume what it means to be justified by faith, you might say, man, I think we've exhausted this subject, but you know what? You can't do that. You can't exhaust, because in heaven and in the next, you know, eons, billions of years to come, we're talking about how good it was to have been justified by faith. And to be in heaven, that's the only way we get in, okay? And this topic is so deeply and vastly wonderful in this life, I can never say all there is to say about it. Now, today I won't specifically say as much about this as I will say, give it to you from the pastor's side, the ones that truly care about the Bible, how it breaks our heart when people move away from it, and how it is a struggle. I want you to understand, and there's no way you can fully understand that. I will say this as a... God has called, and by the way, Brother Bo and his family are not here with us today because he's at Center Baptist Church preaching again today, filling in. And that's what happens when God calls people to do stuff. They don't just always hang around here. Sometimes they're going to take that gift and use it somewhere else. Because I will say this, we are not the only church that preaches the gospel. There are Pentecostal churches that preach the gospel, Baptist, Methodist, non-denominational, independent Baptist, you know, the Second Overcoming Holy Ghost Church of God in Christ with signs, fire, and tongues. Some of them preach the gospel. Some of them don't. Some of them are weird, but some of them preach the gospel, you know. It's there in different places. There's denominations you've not heard about. And then in all these groups, there's also, we're in a serious situation, especially in America today, that a lot of church services are nothing more than entertainment. And they're nothing more than a self-help sermon that, to be honest with you, a motivational speaker could come up and speak and give you some encouragement. I mean, I hear sometimes more gospel in some of the business meetings that I attend because some Christians speak up and say, I give God the credit, and I know Jesus is in my life. And, of course, you know, we try not to just preach anything because, that's not our purpose for being there. But I'm just saying that there's a great problem, so we're not going to look like everybody else. And now's the time to stand strong for the gospel. And again, the good news is through the internet and through different things, we're aware that we're not the only ones. There are many all over the world. That's why some people, I believe, out in California and other places are tuning in to us. I don't have any relatives out in California. I don't know anybody in New Zealand. I don't know. We know Alex in Italy. It's finally hit me. This week, that's our Italy person. That's why we've been hitting a lot of, Alex is tuning in. Alex Brooks, you know, the young man went to the military, and Alex still connects with some of us and talks to us and asks questions and things, and we try to encourage him, and we probably need to even make a happy box. Again, he gave me the address. Somebody remind me about that, and we will get something, maybe even part of our VBS time, we might could write a card and send it to him and encourage him. in the Lord, because he's just like all of us. If you're in your late teens, early 20s, we've all had some things that we wonder about sometimes, and he does too. And like I told somebody the other day, I understand what it means to be, you know, I understand what it means to be 19. You know, he can't tell me how to be 55, but I can say I remember what it was like to be 19, 20, and help him. So so these things, when we try to apply the gospel, and he's listening to the gospel. But so far we've dealt with the personal argument, the scriptural argument, the logical argument, and the dispensational argument. And I closed with the end of that last sermon in this series. And again, the other things we've done in Zephaniah, they all related to this. The one I did in Psalms, still related to this subject. It showed you that in the Old Testament, there was still some gospel going on. And so this particular, you know, the Apostle Paul, I said in the beginning of this series that he didn't have anything positive to say about the Galatians. And so he followed the thing. If he didn't have anything positive to say, he didn't go out of his way to say something negative unless it was necessary. That's something we should all do. But here he does have a word of commendation for him, and we're going to see that. We call this a sentimental argument, not because it's a sappy, touchy-feely thing, but it deals with the personal relationship that he's bringing up between he and them. And so the first phrase of this passage that we're going to read in a minute tells us that Paul is saying, brethren, which means brothers, and it also referred to the sisters as well. We're not leaving the sisters out. Just in that day and time, they addressed everybody, they said brethren. And it wasn't that long ago we did that. You know, it was just the male gender or the male pronoun was more prominent. But it said, but it really means brothers and sisters. I entreat you or I beseech you in the King James. And that phrase is an appeal made by a loving servant of the Lord, a concerned spiritual father who is addressing his spiritual children. Paul and the Galatians had experienced a loving relationship that was now being strained by their abandonment of the gospel message. And I brought up Brother Bo a minute ago. As I'm talking to him, he's beginning to see, which encourages me that God may be doing more with him. Keep praying for him. Don't know that he's going to leave us anytime soon. He's not planning on it. But God may have other plans for him, because I see that there's a burden on his heart to preach the gospel, and his heart breaks when people forsake the gospel. And that's a good sign of a God-called minister, because I'll tell you, there's a lot of slick hucksters out here today who are just happy to preach a slick little message. They want folks in the building. They're people pleasers. They're, you know, and you can grow that way. You can totally, and I'm not saying everybody's growing is doing that. There are people preaching the gospel and God is adding people there. But there's a lot of slick hucksters out there. And I don't just mean the TV guys. I mean, there's people that they're just slick, you know. And they use business principles more than spiritual principles. And I just want to say this. Some business principles are spiritual principles. The book of Proverbs are full of them. As long as you, you know, stick with the biblical principle, you're okay. But when you start putting, you know, it's just like I said, there is a discontent and disconnect I am seeing with people out in the world that they, even I think some of the younger generation is saying, you know, I need something that's real. I've had all these prepackaged programs, and some of you've served in places where they love you as long as you serve faithfully in the program. But, hey, pull back and say I'm tired a little bit, and they're like, well, we're done with you, you know. You can't set up chairs or do this or that or teach this or that. And it's like, look, I need a break. I'll come back, but I need a break. Well, guess what? We have some churches in the world. I find out that they understand that. That this month that we're in right now is the lowest month of church attendance. I think we're doing good to have the attendance we have here. We know, like, Charles will be on vacation here in a few weeks, and I may talk to y'all. If I have an opportunity to go home and see my aging parents, I may try to do that. I got to talk to my other boss man and see what happens there. I'd love to do that. It's hard, even in business. Some of our retail people say, this is one of the hardest months. You know, people are gone on vacation. They worried about buying stuff. And so these things happen. So guess what? Some churches cut things back just for a little bit and, you know, don't have all the programs and say, y'all go vacate, go rest, go see your relatives, and then we're going to come back and school's getting ready to start in August and we're going to crank it back up full force. And many of those people come back renewed and ready to go. Even Jesus took time out. And so it's not wrong. It's not sinful to do that. But I want us to look today. And I want us to understand we have to love everybody in the body of Christ, but our relationship at times is going to be strained if those people refuse to follow sound doctrine and turn a blind ear to our pleas. Many times people turn to either legalism or vain worldliness, and both extremes are bad. They're very dangerous. So let's look at this appeal, and we're going to do that by reading. Let's just read this passage of Scripture, then I'm going to go to the Lord in prayer. Verse 12 of Ephesians 4. Brothers, I entreat you, become as I am, for I have also become as you are. You did me no wrong. You know it was because of a bodily ailment that I preached the gospel to you at first. And though my condition was a trial to you, and you did not scorn and despise me, but received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus. What then has become of the blessing you felt? For I testify to you that if possible, you would have gouged out your eyes and given them to me. Which says maybe Paul had an eye ailment at that point. Have I then become your enemy by telling you the truth? They make much of you, but for no good purpose. They want to shut you out that they may make much of them. It is always good to be made much of for a good purpose. Not only when I'm present with you, my little children, for whom I am again in the anguish of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. I wish I could be present with you now and change my tone, for I am perplexed about you. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus and ask that you would bless the reading of your word. We pray that you would touch this congregation and give them open ears and minds to understand your word. And Lord, in the midst of a great heat wave, which by the way, Lord, we pray that you would break that for us, because some of us, over the past 8 years I've lived here, I've had 4 times that water threatened my house and got into it. 3 times out of about 5 or 6 that I've had bad storms. So I have to confess, sometimes I get a little nervous when it rains a lot, but it's been dry, Lord. And we need rain. We need cooler temperatures. If you would give that to us. I know my power bill and others here was probably just awful last week. But Lord, we still thank you that we're in a place with air conditioning. We're not at a brush arbor having to try to sit under a shade tree and fan ourselves. We have electrical instruments. At times today, things didn't work like we wanted them to, but they eventually did. And we had a nice tone. It blended well. We had some pleasant music for people to listen to and for us to sing, and we thank you for that. We thank you for the equipment that you've blessed us with in this church, for the hard work that folks did yesterday for Vacation Bible School, for the work we'll do a little later this evening, and for what we'll do this week as we endeavor to share the gospel. And whether we have a large number of children here or whether a lot of us are here, again, hearing the lessons and fellowshipping with one another, we know, just like last year, good will come out of it. And we look forward to that. We're excited about what you're going to do. Lord, we pray for Brother Alex in Italy that you will protect him and watch over him and keep him safe and give him success in what he does and draw him close to you. We pray for others, Lord, who are, again, all over the world who are listening. We pray that they'll find strong congregations that they can attend with others. And if they can't, would you send them a godly pastor, a godly elder, somebody that's steeped in your word, and help them form a house church so that they may eventually form a congregation that would be a gospel light in their community. We know we don't need more religion. We need more Jesus, or we need more true Jesus religion. We know that religion's not bad as long as it's Christ is at the center of it. So today, have mercy upon us as we preach your word. Bring revival to this land, O God. Thank you for what you've done in this nation in the past. Do a mighty work in the future. We ask this in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said,
amen.
So I want to start off by saying that Paul exhorts the Galatians to become as he is. He said, for I have also become like you. You see that in your notes there in point A of Roman numeral 1. Paul left the legalistic system of the Jewish law to bring the gospel to the Gentile Galatians. I want you to tell you this, that the law is not completely legalistic. Now, law is definitely legal, so it has to be legalistic to some point. But the animal sacrifices that were prescribed in the law pointed to Christ's sacrifice on the cross. Well, that's not a legalistic thing. That's a wonderful thing, what it pointed to. In the Psalms and the Prophets, it is mentioned often that God desired a heart of repentance and gratitude before the sacrifice was made. But the Jewish law had added many extra rules and regulations that burdened the people. And there were some laws and regulations that related more to cleanliness and hygiene, before. And by the way, our Seventh or Seventh-day Adventists, they don't tend to eat catfish. And if you are certain types of meat that they would consider unclean, they won't eat pork. I had a friend, a Seventh-day Adventist friend that worked with me. His name was John Dow. And I was always making silly rhymes. My wife just stepped out a minute, but I think I worry her to death sometimes, but she doesn't always appreciate. She doesn't realize the great humor that I have, how great a humorist I am. The kids sort of tolerate that, but my wife thinks it's real goofy. But I remember, and a man's pastor had come by to visit one day, and he had to explain I didn't really mean anything bad about it. He wasn't being persecuted. But we were eating something, and I had a little saying. I wrote, John Dow will eat a cow, but even with a fork, he would eat no pork, you know. And I think the pastor thought I was, you know, persecuting his member. And I said, he said, oh, no, they're just joking. They don't mean anything by it, you know. And we didn't. I love this man. I believe he was a true Christian because he placed his faith and trust in Christ. But some Seventh-day Adventists are way too legalistic. I run into some that I'm afraid probably aren't true believers because they're less about grace and more about rules and about, and you know, again, rules are okay, but we need to understand why we do the rules. But Paul said he became like the Galatians in being free from the law. He's now desiring for them to become like him in being free from legalistic bondage. He said, right. In other words, I became like a minister to the Gentiles. I would eat with Gentiles. A Jew was not supposed to do that. And he did these things. And, you know, Peter had that vision where the sheep came down and God told him to eat. So in that day and time, you know, God was first of all telling us that you can't eat pork and catfish, okay? You can either eat, you know, you can eat pickles, pig feet if that's what you want to do. I don't want to do that, but, you know, you can eat chitlins if you want to. I don't want to do that, but some do. But, you know, you can eat, you know, there's things you can eat. It's not wrong anymore. But those things had good purposes in the Old Testament. I'm sure that in that day and time, years ago, thousands of years ago, folks probably had a lot of cholesterol issues. The Israelites didn't, because they didn't eat a lot of that food. God knew he was keeping them alive in the wilderness by prescribing a diet that was very helpful for them. And, you know, today, you'd still probably be well off not to eat a lot of the wrong kind of pork or, you know, a lot of real fatty, greasy stuff, and even if you are taking cholesterol medicine. But the point was, yes, there's rules and regulations, but why do we have the rules? And Paul said he wanted them to become like him now, and that he was living in the freedom of the Spirit, and he wanted them to live that way. So Paul was wanting them to become as he was, trusting in the gospel. And that's my desire, that everybody in here puts their faith and trust in Jesus, in the biblical gospel. And it's so easy to go either direction. You become licentious and deal with a lot of, well, Jesus will save me, it doesn't matter what I do. Well, yeah, it does matter what you do. If you're truly saved, you'll begin to live like Jesus. Or the other side, well, I got to keep all these rules for Jesus to love me. No, that's not how that works either. Well, secondly, Paul reminds them of the good relationship they had. He said in the beginning, he didn't have much to commend them about. I didn't commend them about anything, but he says here, you did me no wrong. Paul had become ill and had to stay in Galatia longer than he expected. So sometimes we have specific plans about our life and work, don't we? Maybe even our work for Jesus. But God derails them so that we can minister to those he is drawing to salvation. So, you know, it's not all about us, is it? It's about Jesus. It's about God's will. But have you seen this? It was a meme on Facebook some years ago, and you still occasionally see it. It's just, you know, my plan, you know, for life, and it shows a person maybe riding a bicycle, and it's pretty, you know, steady, but God's plan for my life, they're riding, and all of a sudden they have to go down in this deep ravine, they have to go to this place, and they actually have to zip line across this body of water with that crocodiles in it, and then they have to climb this big hill. Yeah, that's God's plan for your life. When my oldest daughter, when she was born, she was sick with a little infection, because that sweet girl was stubborn, she wasn't going to come out of her mama. She had her head back like this, wasn't going to come out, and they had to do a C-section, and we broke her water. I was going to say drained her water, but that's not right. We broke her water, okay, at 5 a.m. in the morning, and she wasn't born until 9 p.m., so she didn't have that amniotic fluid around her, and so she had a little infection, and I remember being very upset, and my mother comes to me and says, this has all happened to you because God loves you. That's true. God was doing something in our life, and he loved us enough to bring us through that trial. It turned out she was not very sick, never really had any big problem, and our church was able to pay for us to stay in the hospital down the hall from her in an extra room they had, so we could stay with her and be close to her, and we were okay. But it really, God loves us, and he loves us enough to you know our God does want us to have happiness and joy. I believe that. But let me tell you, God's way more concerned about you becoming more like Jesus than anything else. And sometimes to do that, you have to go through some tough times, you know, and you have to learn some discipline. And sometimes God lets you fail. You know, as I've told you about the guy from Jamaica that I used to coach soccer with, there was this kid that wasn't really his fault. Mama got him to practice late every week, and coach, first thing the boy would come, he goes, run your lap. Well, that's cruel, coach, y'all not done that. Well, you know, maybe the boy should have done more to help mama get there on time. You know what? Maybe there wasn't anything he could do. He'd done all he could. Well, that's just the way life works sometimes. Life's not fair sometimes. So coach was teaching him that. You're still late, that's our rule, do it. You know, and that's the way things have to go sometimes. And we got a group that wants to buck up against the rules, you know. I mean, it's hard. Some of you who are employing people, you're finding this. It's hard. A lot of folks, you would think, need to work right now, and they still don't want to work. You know, and you're paying them a decent wage. Now, they're not going to become a millionaire from it, but, hey, they can get by. They can do that. But, yeah, people are doing that. They have their plan, but God has a plan. And the Galatians readily received Paul. Here's a good thing. They did that even though he was not completely well. He may have had a runny eye, or he may have had malaria. Something else may have happened. And so he probably didn't look real good, you know. But they focused more on the message than the appearance of the messenger, and they listened. Paul's sickness caused him to stay in Galatia, and he preached the gospel to them. And they were good to him. And in this section, Paul's depth of love for the Galatians is strongly evident. He remembers when they affectionately embraced the gospel of grace. And he grieves now over their departure from that. As I would grieve if you departed from that and begin to trust in thinking you could do enough to earn God's favor. If I saw you struggling with salvation when I knew that you had trusted in Christ. And that Satan does this to people sometimes. He bothers you and he troubles you. And he makes you think, well, God doesn't love you anymore, which is not true, but it happens. We've probably all felt that at times. What have I done to make God not love me? Why am I having all this difficulty? This is why I want you to know the gospel, so you can just kick that out of your mind and say, I don't feel like I'm being loved, but the Word says I am. The Word says that Jesus went to the cross and endured this, and I'm placing my faith and trust in Him. At some point, it's going to get better because God doesn't do anything to harm me. Romans 8 says, you know, if God is for us, who can be against us? If God, who did not give up His only Son, but gave Him up for us. Clarence Jordan in the Cotton Patch Bible, verse 32 says, if God didn't put Him in the game for us. Isn't that wonderful? We were failing and struggling, and God sent Jesus and put Him in the game of life for us. He entered as the baby in the manger. Actually, before that, He entered into the womb of a teenage girl, and right, a Jewish girl, and look what happened. He lived a perfect life, died on the cross, was resurrected, is ascended. We couldn't get it done. Isn't it good, you kids that play ball? Isn't it nice if you know that, hey, we're really struggling, and all of a sudden, the best player in the league comes in and helps us. Genebeth had that experience. Some of you even got to watch that. A few of y'all came to the game. Remember the championship game that we won? It was real obvious, wasn't it, that number 21 was the best player in the league, wasn't it? I mean, that girl could play ball. The other team finally figured it out, and they all sort of ganged up on her, and that's why the team made a comeback. But, you know, was that fun, Genebeth, to play with that girl? I mean, she carried you, didn't she? And she wasn't an arrogant person. She had a Christ-like spirit about her. I mean, she passed the ball to other people. I had to fuss at the girl saying, you know, the girl knows she can't do it all. She's passed it to you. But the good news is Jesus can do it all. But he still chooses, like that girl, to use us. He passes the ball to us sometimes and says, hey, I'm empowering you. Go do this. Go make this bucket. Go defend this. Go do this thing. It's the same way in life. God has put Jesus in the game for us, and we need to focus on that. We are loved by Jesus, but what happened to the Galatians? And this is a danger that we got to be careful about. And I know I'm a little over time, but I promise you we're going to sum this up. The Galatians had lost their first love for Jesus. As A.W. Tozer had said one time, the Galatians had become politely bored with God. Aren't we a group of people in our society today that gets easily bored? We do. I mean, you know, I have to say for the most part I'm not bored. Because I hear kids say I'm bored, and I'm like, it's been a long time since I've outright been bored. I have so many things on my plate, but I get it. I mean, even with the social media and stuff, everything's real quick. Everything's real, you know, it's just nothing keeps our attention very long. That's why some of y'all need to have a habit of reading some books. Some full books, read the whole thing, and get that back in there, or you're always, it's starting to affect our brains in a bad way. And so these Galatians, when they became politely bored with God, here's what will happen when people do that. They will either move to other philosophies, they'll even dabble with some other religions, and some Christians do that, don't they? Or or professing Christians do anyway, or they will embrace a works-oriented righteousness and try to earn their favor, because that's what human religiousness will do. And I just want to tell y'all, it is good to be busy for the Lord. I want y'all to be busy for Him. But sometimes we've got to stop and simply soak up His grace and mercy and do that. Then we can go out and work. I am learning that I am not 25 years old anymore. And I have, in addition to struggling with some diabetes, I have ulcerative colitis. And let me just say that I don't have the gross symptoms of that. I don't run pooping in my rear end, by my pants and all that. I don't do that. Some people that have, I don't have that problem. But I do have times it affects my immunity. I have times it affects my energy. And so I've learned I got to sleep at night. I've got to get some rest. If I'm going to be any good for my boss man, if I'm going to be any good for this church, I've got to get enough sleep. I got to make that happen. And I've got to do that. And I got a few other things I need to do. But some of my ailments have told me that I don't have an endless bundle of energy. I have to work on things. I have to plan for things. I have to stop and soak up. If I'm going to preach for you, I've got to spend time in the Word. And not only studying the Bible, but listening to sermons and listening to Christian music. We have to prepare ourselves for God. We have to soak that up. But a lot of people want to be going. And yes, we need to do for the Lord. We don't need to be lazy. I'm telling you, we need to serve. This week, we need you to help us serve the Lord in VBS. But listen, we also must be careful not to be good people who do good things outside of God's will. By good, I mean moral people. None of us are good apart from Christ. But I think you understand what I mean. I serve with a pastor that used that phrase a lot. A lot of people are good people doing good things outside of God's will. If God's blocking you from doing something for Him, then do what He's allowing you to do. He'll open the door later. But a lot of people get mad because God blocked them from something. Well, you know, like Garth Brooks saying years ago, sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. I get it, you know, because it's before I started dating my wife, but I thought I was in love with this girl. And I just thank God that didn't work out now, you know. But one of us would choke the other one. You know, this would not have been a good thing. It would not have been a good thing. But I thought it was a great thing at the time. But God said no to that. Praise the Lord for that. Okay. And I thank God now. I didn't at the time. But we got to be good. We just got to serve the Lord and accept what He's bringing into our life. And also, you know, with this relationship, Paul was jealous for these folks with a godly jealousy. Paul saw the false sincerity of the false teachers. These guys were slick and charming. And it's easy to be swayed by spiritual leaders who desire to be people pleasers. Speaking the truth will sometimes lead to estrangement. I mean, when somebody rebukes us, we don't say, well, glory. Hallelujah, they rebuked me. Man, I love that. Oh, no, you get a little mad about it, don't you? Or a little irritated. But then sometimes I think about it. The Holy Spirit deals with me and I say, I needed to listen to that. Paul genuinely loved the Galatians. He was willing to speak hard truths to them. He loved them, whether he was with them or, as in this situation, he was absent from them. Matthew Henry, the great commentator, has said, ministers may be easy in their own minds when they are conscious to themselves that if others have become their enemies, it is only for telling them the truth. That still bothers us that they became our enemies, but that happens sometimes. Paul also points out in this passage, and you'll see it, like I say, he talks about the zeal that they had. Verse 17, they're making much of you. And he takes it verse 18, it's always good to be made much of for a good purpose. You know, sometimes we have zeal for the wrong thing, though. Matthew Henry goes on to say, there may yet appear to be a great deal of zeal where there's yet but little truth and sincerity. Bodie Balcom has said this, we have a generation today that's passionately worshiping a God. They'll go to church and churches have become more like a rave today with the kind of worldly music. And again, I'm not saying that all modern music's worldly and bad. There are some modern praise and worship songs that do a great job of glorifying Jesus. Lorinda has sung one, and even she's had a Julie and a Catherine sing with her the Revelation song. That's taken directly out of the book of Revelation. It is scriptural. It is a good song. Sing. If you want to introduce it to the congregation and teach it to all of us, Linda, that'd be wonderful, because that's a great modern-day worship song that's great. You know, there are good songs today, but the sad part about it is some of the best worship songs being written by Roman Catholic dude, which I got some problems with Roman Catholicism. That to me, that's sad. But Matt Maher writes some of the better songs that's steeped in Scripture, because he has at least opened his Bible and written songs based on Scripture, and you're never going to go wrong when you do that. But there are other good people writing scriptural songs, but they don't always get played on KSBJ or other places. Keith and Christian Getty have written some wonderful worship songs, modern day hymns. There's some great stuff being written, but it doesn't always make the playlist. But we've got to be careful there about letting people seduce us with music and with all of these other things. There can be a lot of zeal. And so what Vody Bachum was saying is people here worshiping passionately a God that they don't know very well and don't know much about him. They don't know about his holiness, his greatness. You know, I remember a few years ago, I was writing a worship service, the musical portion, we used to have a thing called Friend Day in our church I served at in Florida. And at Friend Day, what we did was we invited people, you know, friends. You know, we had a big day, had a picnic later. But I remember our drummer was saying, man, you know, some of these are some older songs. To appeal to a newer crowd, maybe should we write some new things? And this was around 2011. And if you might remember at that time, all over my Facebook page, people who weren't even Christians were sharing Carrie Underwood singing How Great Thou Art. And I said, well, ma'am, if I'm inviting lost people to church, they know How Great Thou Art. They listen to Carrie Underwood sing it, you know. They're going to sing along with us if we sing that. And we sing a brand new one that's on the Christian charts. They don't even know that song. They don't listen to Christian music, you know. They know Amazing Grace. And we sang Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone, that our group sings. It was fairly new then, that version was. And so they could know that. So, you know, if you're going to reach lost people with music, I tell you, they know the Old Rugged Cross, Amazing Grace, and How Great Thou Art way better than they know some of the new songs. Now, I'm not saying don't sing the new songs. I'm just saying, we say sing along with us. I promise you, they're going to, this music that we play, this gospel style music that we play, man, I think it appeals to more people than we realize. And it does, because it's energetic, it's exciting. And then we can get excited about the message. You know, I spoke about zeal a moment ago. Let me just quickly back up to that. There's this church I watch occasionally, don't agree with all their doctrine. It's called Dallas North Carolina Church of God. And they have this service. You can go on the YouTube and find it. It says Holy Ghost service, and it's one of those that you get the whole service. They start off with a beautiful ballad, I think one that Jesse Dixon sang years ago called I Am Redeemed. And then they had this. It was a beautiful worship song. The minister of youth at the time comes out and sings a beautiful ballad about the blood of Jesus, how precious it is. And then somebody in the church wrote this song. And it's the verse first speaks about the historical truth of what happened the morning the ladies came to the tomb and saw that Jesus was risen. And the chorus says, he has won the victory. He's not in the grave. The cross was temporary. He shed his blood to save. We are ones he died for to save us from our sin. He's alive forevermore, sitting at the Father's right hand. Then the next verse goes on to tell about how Jesus had personally saved the writer of the song and how he had changed their life. And they then began to sing the chorus multiple times. And this was an old-fashioned Pentecostal-style church. Some of them folks got to shouting like you people get them hollering at a ball game. A couple of them got to running down the aisles. I mean, it turned into a shouting service. I mean, and by the way, I want you to know, when you're in the spirit, you don't have to get crazy. The man who was singing the solo, he brings his wife up, and they begin to pray together, and the music minister had enough, the lady that was directing the choir had enough sense to know they got a little toddler in mama's hand, and she's going to get happy the Lord dropped that baby. So she took her and she's directing the choir while holding the baby. You know, they didn't lose all their good sense. None of them crashed into one another and they were running the aisles. But one dear sister comes down front and she's dancing before the Lord. And it's not to be foolish. They got excited that Jesus, what he had done for them. And I've noticed something about this church. They got some great musicians. I mean, they can play. They got horn players. Pastor Lee plays a lead guitar. Got a great pianist and organist. They got drummers. They do it all. And they're great. And they have great energetic music. But it's Jesus that they get excited about. That's what it's good to be excited about, is Jesus. You need to be excited about Jesus. Maybe we've not led more people to Jesus because we're not just excited about him. Be excited about him. But don't be excited about all this foolishness. A lot of people are excited about this sentimental feeling that they get. Well, I'm bad that I've gone through some hard times. I don't like the hard times, but I get excited about what God accomplished through them. So Paul worries about these folks being these slick, false teachers. And so quickly, let me just say here, with Paul's deep concern for and perplexity about the Galatians, he says, first of all, that he was not like them. Okay? He still loved them even though they had grown cold toward him in his absence. He had not grown cold toward them, but they had grown cold toward him. Paul was different from these false teachers. He spoke the truth even if it would offend those he loved. I hear people saying, I always loved Brother So-and-so. He is such a great pastor. And sometimes Brother So-and-so was a great pastor. But can I tell you, sometimes Brother So-and-so wasn't nothing but a brown-nosed person that just got along with everybody and was a slick kind of dude. And he never would preach the truth. I have served with somebody before that people begin to get under conviction and a joke would be told to kill that because he was worried that people wouldn't like him to preaching anymore. Man, I'm going to tell you, I don't want y'all to frown at me and get mad at me. But I fear God way more than I fear you. Okay? I got to answer to him. I have to answer to you. Now, I do have to, hopefully, I do have to answer to you if I'm preaching false doctrine. You should say something about that. But what I'm saying is that's just, you got to speak the truth. And the false teachers pretended to have great affection for the Galatians, but only because they wanted to promote their own selfish interest. Some of y'all went to that ball game that Jenna Best team won the championship with. Y'all remember the strong, tall, black girl that played in the middle some until the other really best player got to the middle? You know what? You know why she did that? Because her grandma was always getting on to her about it. And guess what I had to do in some games? Annalise, get in your spot. Get in your zone. Now, I didn't say that. Annalise, sweet baby, it would be good. I'm like, don't get in your zone now. You know? I mean, you have to do that in the game. Well, maybe you don't have to. Some of you might remember the great Tom Landry who was stoic on the sideline. That is not me, okay? If you play for me, I'm going to yell at you, okay? Because I want you to, if you're not where you're supposed to be, you got to get where you're supposed to be, okay? We've rehearsed this. We've practiced it. We're going to lose if you don't, okay? And then you're going to be sad. And that's the other part I remind them. Well, after the game, if you don't do this, you're going to be crying and, oh, we're lost, coach. It's like, well, if you do what I tell you to do, you're going to lose, you know? Unless they're just way better than you. And then you just did all you can do there. But you see what I'm saying? If you love people, if a coach loves his team, he has to get on to them. A pastor sometimes has to do that. A parent has to do that. Part of the problem in this world today is too many people wanting to be a buddy to their kids, and sometimes you got to be mom and daddy and say no. So faithful ministers long for their spiritual children to have Christ formed in them. And so seeing this take place will calm the minds of godly leaders. Godly leaders want the body of Christ to be firmly settled, want them to be firmly confirmed in the Christian faith and life. And here's what happens, y'all. And this, I want you to get this. If you don't get anything else in this lesson, this is where justification by faith comes in. Christ is not fully formed in people until they are brought from trusting in their own righteousness and come to fully rely on Jesus and His righteousness. Amen. That's when you get saved. When I say that's when you get saved, you have to do that when you get saved, but sometimes you don't have that full understanding. So much of the world's around you, that there's so much religion around you, that people still have their rules of religion. And I was watching an interview that, actually a declaration, a video clip of John MacArthur that said he got called one night. He gets on Larry King had a show. For some reason or other, John MacArthur was one of the guests, and John would always just speak the gospel. And he said, man, how do you deal with that? How do you prepare? You don't even know what Larry's going to answer. He says, well, I'm just always going to share the gospel. It really doesn't matter what the answer to the question is. I'm always going to share what Jesus says. And said, one day, this is when Madonna, so y'all know who Madonna is, any younger people, you ever heard of Madonna? Okay. The older people know, but that was a pop star. She's about 60 years old now. She was a pop star and a strange pop star, did some strange things. But she was married to a guy named Guy Ritchie. And Guy calls up John and wants to, can you come talk to me? I got some questions. So John shows up. Well, Guy ends up asking him, well, really, he thought it was going to be this serious question. And I guess it was serious to Guy, but it was, man, why are you so dogmatic about things? You're throwing off the equilibrium of the universe. Because this guy was into some weird Kabbalah kind of thing where it was good has to balance evil and evil has to balance good. And John said, I let him talk for a while. Then I spent an hour sharing the gospel with him. And all I'm saying is I hope the guy gets saved. He's not with Madonna anymore, so Madonna's gone deeper into some weirdness. Who knows? Maybe it had some good to do. But we have to share Jesus, and John will tell people you have to fully rely on Jesus, and that offends people. And people don't like that. So Matthew Henry, I'm going to close with this because I'm over time. Though ministers too often find it necessary to reprove those they have to do with, yet this is no grateful work to them. We don't like doing it. They had much rather there was no occasion for it and are always glad when they can see reason to change their voice towards them. So it's always wonderful when you embrace the gospel. I haven't seen y'all forsaking the gospel. But the reason, Brother Mike, sounds like a broken record around here is we've got to get the gospel right. And many places don't, and I'm not happy about that. I don't look down my nose at other places. But I don't know where I'd go to church if I didn't go to church here. I mean, there's some other churches that I would. And there would be some other Baptist churches that I'd go to church with. But there's many I wouldn't go to church there. It's possible that I might live in a place that I'd say, I got to start a house church. I mean, I would be nice to the other folks and I would try to help them, but the gospel's just not being preached. I lived in one town that I said, if I didn't serve in the church where I was, I'd gone to Assembly of God church because I knew that pastor preached the gospel. I might not even could go to my own denomination because everybody was preaching some touchy-feely kind of Jesus. What do? You know, my daughter for a while, even though she was serving in one church, went to an Anglican church because it was a conservative Anglican church that preached the Bible or taught the Bible and read the Bible and made the Bible the practice of what they did. So they did, you know what I'm saying? That's got to be the thing, and that's not popular with everybody. So as the musicians come, and I know Lorinda's picked a commitment song, you can sing it, you know, you can come forward and we pray, or you can let it be your prayer. I'm here to pray with you if you need prayer, okay? I will do that. But let me just encourage you to trust in Jesus and Him only. If you want to throw a birthday party for me at some point, pastor appreciation, that's great. I appreciate it. But the number one thing you need to bless my heart is follow Jesus and stick to the gospel.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Is this
stand? Yes, sir.
Yeah, let's all stand. Just as I am.
Just
as I am. Page 187.
You can come just as you am. If you come to Jesus, He won't leave you that way. Amen. Amen. But you can come on. We're here to help you today.
Just as I am.
Suffer the little children, let them come unto me, and I will.